Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, you had a nice lunch? Was it nice? Okay. So can I expect some loud noise? Because, I mean, it's like as if I'm in a hall where I'm in a, you know, in one of those old school days where a teacher is asking something and nobody wants to speak. It's like one of those kind of scenarios. So it would be good if all of us can talk. For the next session, we have Nishi Jain, who will be presenting about web SDKs and how you can switch between various services on the fly, in the sense that anything you build, you end up using multiple services for your application. So this talk would give you an outline of how that can be done and how she herself has fiddled around that. So Nishi, you can go ahead and start. Yeah.
Hello everybody, I'm Nishi Jain. I'm glad to be here today. I'll be sharing one of my very interesting experience I recently had. A bit about myself, I'm currently working on an application that manages video and content workflows in Hotstar. And prior to Hotstar, I was working as a web developer with Paytm. So my topic of discussion today is web SDK, multiple providers per service and one software development kit. So before I get started with the topic, a bit of history about us. Hotstar started as an experiment in the OTT platform. Star has an abundance of content, and with the amount of people spend on their personal devices, we realized that there's an opportunity ahead to create on-demand content accessibility for the users. So started back in 2015, today we stand as a highly evolved video streaming platform. But in our journey till now, we have faced multiple challenges, and to each of these challenges, we have managed to find a smart solution. So here I am discussing today one of the very interesting challenges we had and our solution towards it. So let's get started. So in common scenarios, web operations are dependent on an API response. There's an API that empowers the web operation in an application to fetch the required data from the backend. But in our scenario, this looks slightly different. So in our scenario, it looks something like this. So if you look over here, there's for a particular web operation, web is accessing an API. But for different percentage of the users, it is fetching the data from an API maintained by a different provider. So how is it happening and why is the scenario like this? As I said, that we started as an experiment. So Hotstar earlier was an amalgamation of multiple third-party services. But with the kind of response we were getting from our audience, we realized that we should have our own tech team and we should soon move to our in-house services. Now this transition period between the third-party service to the in-house services was challenging because moving to the in-house service was not possible in one go. So during this transition period, there was a requirement to have the third-party services and the in-house services run parallelly until and unless we are completely sure about the in-house service. So there's this X percentage of the traffic for any particular web operation which is directed to the third-party services, and the Y percentage of the traffic is directed to the in-house service. Now, the goal over here is to increase the percentage of Y, to increase the value of Y, reduce X, and kill X once we are completely sure of Y. So in a non-tech world, our problem looks to something like this. If you see over here, there's a man who is performing a split operation between these two buses. Now, this operation of the man is controlled by a remote. So how I see this, how I compare this to our scenario is, I think the buses resemble to the services, the third-party service and the in-house service that we are currently working on. The man is comparable to the web, who is currently dependent. The man is dependent for the split operation between the buses. Our web is dependent for any web operation on the multiple services, the third-party service and the in-house service. Now, we wanted to make this remote that could control the dependency of the man on the different services for a particular operation. So this was challenging. Before coming to the final solutions, there were certain approaches we thought of, and we with each approach that we picked, we could figure out that what was wrong before we came to the final solution. So I'll take you through each solution step by step. Approach one was that whatever change we make in our APIs, let's implement that change in the code base. And if things don't work, we'll roll back to the previous version. But as you see, the drawback over here is that we'll be moving back and forth between the recent implementations we are making. If things don't work, we'll have to roll back to the previous code base. And also, there's a service layer and the huge web code base, which is there in one repo. And whenever there's any change in the service layer, we'll have to make a deployment for the entire web code base. So this is something we didn't want. And also, we foresee that there'll be the third-party code, a lot of third-party code, which we want to get away with in future. So we wanted to keep that code separate. We didn't want it to get merged with the web code base and the service code base that we'll be keeping for the future. So this approach didn't work for us. Now the approach two was that let's keep all the API implementations, third-party API implementation, our in-house API implementation, all the implementations that are required for a particular operation at a time. And whenever web makes any call to the API, whenever it wants any result for the, it wants to get the data for any operation from the backend, it just mentions the provider from which it wants to fetch the data. By provider over here, I mean that whether it wants to fetch the data from the third-party API, whether it wants to fetch the data from the in-house API. So over here, the challenge was that even if we were having multiple implementations of the services, we were still referring to only one API implementation at a time. For example, if the web was saying that, okay, I want to do this operation and third-party provider will do this operation for me. So even when we were having the API implementation of the in-house provider, the web was only referring to the third-party provider. For making the change, we'll have to make the hard coding or the provider change in the API operation itself. And then again, there'll be a deployment. Then only we'll switch to another provider. So we wanted web to be completely agnostic of the fact that from where it is able to get the response. And also, again, the deployments of view layer and API implementation is not independent in this case as well. But the one problem that was solved over here is that we were having multiple API implementations at a time. Of the API implementations that are responsible for a particular web operation, at a time we are not going back and forth between multiple implementations. So the third approach that we came to was, okay, let's have a private NPM repository. What we'll do is we'll keep all the API implementations separate. We'll have a service layer, and our view layer will be separate, and there'll be a config in between. What will this config do is that it will map all the web operations, the operations that are dependent on somehow on the data that is stored in the backend. So these operations are mapped to the provider code. The config maintains this mapping. So whenever the web wants to do any operation, it refers to the config that, okay, this operation is mapped to which provider, and it calls out to the API of that particular provider. So over here, most of the problems are solved, but the drawback was that we were having one repository for the API implementations, one for the config, and other the view layer. But as this solved most of our problems, we went with the approach three. We adopted approach three, and we call it Web SDK today. What is Web SDK? SDK is a wrapper around all our APIs. It is a service layer of web. It consists of API implementations for a particular operation from all our providers. And it also consists of the proper test suite, a very robust test suite, so that the development of Web SDK is not any way dependent on its integration with web. So let's say whenever we want to integrate any API or any change in the API, we just change our test case. And we make sure that all our test cases are running, and the development in our web code base and the SDK code base can be done independently. So how is the Web SDK, why it's an SDK and not an API layer? So I think SDK is something that is more complex, and API is the simplest version of an SDK. SDK is something that that is responsible or that makes that the operation of something that enables to create certain application. It is, whereas an API is an interface that enables to interact between two different services. For let's say, if there are two different software who wants to interact with each other, there'll be an API that will enable the communication between these two softwares. But SDK is a development tool which enables us to create a software that can run on a specific platform. So in our case, we call it an SDK and not just an API. Now, how a particular operation that in web that is dependent on the data, on the backend data, happens in Hotstar. So let's say if I want to fetch the details for this page, there's a tournament and I want to get all the details of the page. I'm over here, I'm not in normal scenario, what happens is I'll just call the API and the results will be fetched. But but we do it in a slightly different way. How we are doing it is, for a particular operation, web makes a call to Web SDK. It says, hey, Web SDK, fetch the details for this operation for me. SDK now knows the operation, incoming operation from the web. It sees that this operation in the config is mapped to which provider. By provider, I mean that it from which provider's API it should get the data from. Now, once it knows the provider, it calls out the API of that provider. It converts the response coming from the API into the web understandable format and return it to the web. So this is something, the development looks like. If you look over here, Hotstar SDK content.get season page data is how web is making a call to the SDK. Over here, there's just the operation name and the request information that is required. So web is saying to the SDK that, okay, I want to get all the season page data for this particular page. And it is giving certain request parameters which SDK will consume to do this operation for web. Now, if you see over here, web is completely agnostic of who is fetching the data response for web, whether it is a third-party provider or it is an in-house provider. SDK refers the config. It is seeing that, okay, in the config, get season page data is mapped to CMS. So it will call out the get season page data implementation of CMS, and it will return the response to the web. Get season page data operation over here will have multiple implementations. One of CMS, let's say AGS, which is a third party implementation, but it is this config which tells the SDK that, okay, I want to call out the implementation to do this operation from CMS. Now, we are keeping multiple API implementations of different providers, but how we are making sure that different percentage of the traffic get served from different APIs. So let's say what we do is we keep different versions of this config. These are all the operations for which web can interact with the web SDK, for which the web is dependent on some backend response. So it will make the call to the web SDK. Now, we can have multiple versions of this config. Now let's say in version one, this get season page data operation is mapped to CMS. And in version two, it is mapped to the code of some different provider. So let's say in version two, get season page data is mapped to AGS. So at the CDN level, what we do is we direct different percentage of the traffic to different versions of this config. So this is how we make sure that X percentage get served from version one, and Y percentage gets served from version two. So for a specific operation, web is able to get the response from two different APIs maintained by two different providers. And until and unless we are completely sure of the provider which we want to go with, we maintain different versions, and we just increase the percentage gradually until and unless we are completely sure. Because in the case of live match, if things fail on production, it is difficult to recover. That's why we wanted this transition from the third party to the in-house services to be gradual and not in one go. The second challenge in this approach was normalizing request and response. So when showed you over here that how web is making a call to the web SDK. Over there, it was completely agnostic that who is fetching the response for that operation from the web SDK. So the request is in certain format. It is not requesting SDK in a format that will be acceptable by the provider, because there are different provider implementation. And again, the response that will be fetched from different providers will not be same and will not be necessarily in the same format in which the web will expect it. So we need to normalize these requests and response in a certain format that this can be consumed by web and the request can be used by the providers to fetch the desired response. So before I come to this topic that how we are doing it, there's this interesting concept in JavaScript that we are using to create the normalization functions, decorators. So decorator is an expression that returns a function and it takes a target name and a descriptor as arguments. So what is a target is? A target is any object, name is any property of that object, and descriptor is the value of that particular property on the object. So decorator is something that adds some extra functionality on the property which it is trying to decorate. And it is applied by adding @ on that particular expression. So if you see over here in the example, @ read only is a very simple and clean decorator we have created. So we are using the concept of decorators to create request adapters and response adapters at our end. What these request adapters and response adapters do is they convert the incoming request into something that is understandable by the API provider, which will fetch the response. And also, once the response is fetched by the API, we convert the response. Again, we have a adapter written by using a decorator. What this adapter do is this converts the response into a format that web understands. So if you look over here, there's this request I have shown which is coming from the web. It is mentioning the operation name and the request parameter. There are multiple implementations for this particular operation. One implementation is managed by the provider CMS, another is maintained by AGS. The request expected by both these providers is different. So I need a normalizer in between that could convert this request into the format that is expected by the CMS API or the AGS API, depending on whosoever fetches the response for this particular operation. And also I want a normalizer that could convert the response as the response received from both these both these providers is different. I need a normalizer that could convert the response into a standard format which is expected by the web. Web obviously understands one format. We cannot write the web code base so that it can handle the response which it will be getting from the different API implementations over here. So, and also we have, from the very start, we have believed in the fact that we'll keep the web agnostic of the API implementations. The web will never depend on which API is fetching the data for the web. So request adapter takes a function as an argument. This function is a normalizer function, and it is called before we call the provider implementation. So this is how a request adapter looks like. If you see, this is a very simple decorator function which we have created, and we are using it to normalize all the requests of all the incoming operations in the web SDK. Over here, the adapter to attach function is passed as a normalizer function, and before we actually made call out to the property which this request adapter is decorating, we pass the incoming request to the adapter to attach function. The adapter to attach function converts this incoming request into the format that is expected by the provider implementation. Now, the decorator over here is doing a job in a very clean way, and we are using this common request adapter for all the operations to do the normalization of the request. Similarly, there are response adapters. So again, the response adapter takes a function as an argument, and it is called after the provider implementation is called. So the response that is fetched from the provider implementation is passed to the response adapters, and the response adapters converts it into the response format expected by the web. So if you look over here, the response adapter is taking an adapter to attach function, and this adapter to attach function is called after we call the API implementation. The response fetched from the API implementation is passed to the adapter to attach function. Now, what this adapter to attach function is doing is it is converting the response into the format which web expect from that particular operation. Now, this is how the overall implementation looks like. Any get season page data has a decorator request adapter and the response adapter. It is taking the normalizer request normalizer and the response normalizer as a parameter. Request adapter is called before the API implementation, and the response fetched from the API implementation is passed to the response adapter. And finally, the decorated or the once the response is converted into the format that is expected by the web, it is returned to the web. So the overall implementation looks clean, and this is how we have made it by creating just the normalization function, separating the normalizer functions, and creating the request adapter and response adapter as common for all the different API implementations. Now there's a cache layer in between. For all the API endpoints that Web SDK fetches the response for, we cache this response and we set the expiry time. Now this expiry time is set for 5 minutes from the time when when the response is fetched. After every 5 minutes, there is this timer that runs, and it deletes or it clears the cache for the API endpoint response for which the expiry time has surpassed or it has occurred. So this is how we maintain the 5 minute cache at our end. Now if you see over here, there's corresponding to every API endpoint, there is the response we are fetching from that API endpoint is stored, and also the expiry time. The expiry time is any time that you can set, but after every 5 minutes, it will just clear the response from the cache for which the expiry time has occurred, or the response that has already expired. Now, all the related modules in the Web SDK are bundled together into one chunk. For example, all the API implementations related to the content module are kept in one chunk. All the API implementations related to search module are kept in one chunk. Once the chunk is loaded in web, it gets cached, and it is not imported when the user revisits the same route. This is something that is handled by Webpack, and it also helps us in maintaining the cache for different chunks that are loaded at the web end. Now, how is this Web SDK integrated with the web? As I said that we are maintaining web code base as separate and Web SDK as separate. Now, how are we integrating the web into the web SDK into the web is that Web SDK is created as a private NPM module. So it is integrated in the web as any other NPM package. It is created as a NPM dependency. And whenever there is any new release going for the Web SDK, the version is updated in the web. How we update the version of the Web SDK is an automated process. In the last commit before any release, we specify that whether it is a patch release, it is a minor release, or it is a major release. There's an automated script that runs which reads this prefix that whether it is a patch, minor, and major, and accordingly, using the subversioning, it creates a new release version. And the same new release version is updated in the package.json of the web repository. But yeah, configuring a private NPM registry is not an easy process. It has its own pros and cons that I'll just come later after this. So how do you configure a private NPM registry is you have this .npmrc file. This npmrc file is added, consists of your private registry path. So whenever you are making any npm install, what it checks that whether that module exists in your private repository. If it is there in the private repository, it fetches that module from the private repository. If it is not, then it accesses the global npm registry. And also you can, to make any change published to your private NPM registry, you can specify the published config parameter in your package.json, which consists of the path of your NPM registry. Now, what are the pros and cons of having a private NPM registry? The pros is obviously that you can maintain your own private packages like we have maintained a Web SDK. You can override the public packages for your internal use. You can give read-write access to the private packages so that different users can collaborate on what you are making. The cons are that it is paid, and maintaining this private NPM registry is a bit of a challenge, and there's a person needed to maintain and make any changes required with the private NPM registry. Now, what was the achievements with this was that we could easily go through this all our third-party services to the in-house services. Removing the older code base was not a challenge for us because since the very start, we have thought of this problem which will occur in future, and we have maintained it all the third party's code base in a separate repo, in a separate folder, and it was as easy as removing one folder for us. We even though we have moved to the in-house services, we continue to follow this approach of having a separate, we can focus whenever there's on the UI part and the API change part separately. Yeah, I think I'm done with the talk, so if any questions are there. Yeah, thank you, you can, the heap is, it is just done, heap store is nothing, but it is simply a JavaScript object at our end. And corresponding to each API endpoint, we are having this object which stores the response of corresponding to that endpoint and the expiry time. So heap is not actually Java heap. It is simply an object that we have named as heap store. It is simply a JavaScript object which consists of the API endpoint as the property name, and this property in an object consists of the response which you fetch from that API endpoint. And also we have set an expiry time. And once you have the expiry time has occurred, there will be a timer that runs, and this will clean this API response from the cache. So during that time period, if there is any other request that comes in, the web SDK will not make the call, and it will get the response from the cache itself. The cache that is maintained in the SDK. So SDK is a NPM module that we have imported, a private NPM module that we are importing on the in the web itself. No, it is not the JavaScript. It is not the Java heap. It is simple. It is a Java. It is a JavaScript object only. Yeah. It is on the client side. It is on the client side. Because at the end we are fetching the so that is why we are just storing it for 5 minutes, right?
Yeah, 5 minutes.
Sorry? But it is just an object. It is not we are storing it in local storage. It is just this object that we maintain. We are not keeping it in any local storage or something. You can ask me on my Twitter handle, or you can mail me if there's any problem.
Anybody else have any questions around that? Yes.
Registry that you have, so you need to maintain it explicitly. No, I mentioned that these two challenges that it is paid, and you need to explicitly maintain that private NPM registry. You need to have separate permission configuration for each module or each package that you have in your registry. Anything else? That is something we haven't tried, but we wanted it to be as an NPM module in our package JSON, so that we can, and NPM provides a good versioning system that we wanted to use, because we wanted to have a version update whenever we are making any change in the web SDK, and we'll make that change in the package.json of the web. So this is because of the versioning system that NPM provides, we were more inclined towards NPM.
Repository with the stats will also work. I think we can have it offline or during the BYF session. You can probably touch on that. Thanks, Nishi, for that talk. And for the next session, we have Shreyans Pandey, who is going to present about architecture built for scale and how. Yes, you can start. Yeah, and how it was set up for the Node.js project that they have been working on. Also, all the participants who have submitted their flash talks, please be ready. Please be prepared. We'll have flash talks right after Shreyans Pandey's session. So, yep.
All right. Can everyone hear me? All good? All right. Thanks a lot, Arun, for the introduction, and thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, to you know, have spent the time and be here with me as I have a chat about my experience as a Node.js developer. So I'll just tell you the title of the talk. It's The Musings of a Frustrated Developer, and this comes from the pure vexing nature of Node.js or JavaScript, I would say, as the more perceptive of you may have assumed. With that said, I'm Shreyansh. Lovely to meet you. And I write code, obviously. That's why I'm here. And those are some of my handles. Please don't judge me for the last two. I was young. And I'm really horrible at just making presentations. So why am I giving this talk? Why am I having a chat with you about some of the things I've learned? Because it's actually important to see some of the more easy to make mistakes while we are learning to be a developer. And I think so, ma'am here asked, you know, the entire crowd who's presenting, what is the good method of sort of getting into the development scene? So you can imagine this to be sort of something along those lines where I'm giving you advice or where I'm telling you what I have experienced so you don't have to do that yourself. With that said, the other reason, and as many of the engineers will agree with me, is that because no one can write bug-free code. I disagree with that statement, and for a very simple reason, because there is a way. And I'll just show you that way. It's you run this lovely command, and then you burn the computer, and then you can live as a monk, which works out lovely, which works out very nicely if you're working with JavaScript. So with all of that aside, let's actually go into the presentation. Tour is to human, and tour and prod is JS. Now, I'll just tell you a couple of the things which we'll be sort of covering in this presentation. In college, we learn how memory works, right? Sadly, sometimes you forget how that happens in JavaScript because, well, it is JavaScript, and nothing is what it seems like. And how we are using JSON for literally everything. Actually, I work with cryptography, and sometimes I don't really know why I have messed something up in my code. Where I log a lot, because as you can imagine, that I talk a lot. So of course, that translates to logging while I'm writing code. And how configuration is just my new sort of pet peeve, I would say. And Express for the win, of course. So just a quick note here. I love Friends. How many of you watch Friends? Excellent crowd. So this is the first sort of episode, I would say, the one where I forgot how memory works. And just to lay down on the application we are working with, something to give you a little bit of a context. So this application gets PDF files and sort of analyzes them of how good they are. Now, when I say good, I mean how useful they are for the end users. It's written in Express, by the way. At lovely 2:57 a.m., I get a nice notification from AWS saying that something is an alarm. And well, it restarted. Great. No biggie. We had around, you know, more than 15 nodes to sort of cluster for all the traffic which we had. But what we noticed after, I think, it's around half an hour, was that every 20 minutes I was getting a notification, and I don't know why I was getting it, but it was of a failing node, which would then restart, and the same thing will continue to happen ad infinitum. So the first thought, right, you know, as a responsible sort of engineer, the first thought should be that, you know, after solid contemplation, you decide that, okay, I'm going to just go into the prod environment, and I'm going to debug it. I was watching Rick and Morty, so pardon me for the interruption there. But finally, I got around to doing it, and there's this very simple command. If anyone can tell me what this does. Yes, so this is an SSH tunnel, which means that I'm connecting to... Let's not... right, so I can basically access the port on the right, which is on the system, which I'm trying to access the port on the left, very simply put. And, you know, as the first thing I'll do is just get into the logging of whatever is happening in my application. And, you know, there's this lovely garbage collector in Node.js. And this is the thing I see that, you know, it's working properly, but in two ticks, which is, I would say, a couple of milliseconds or nanoseconds, depending on how many for loops you have in your application or the complexity, it was just skyrocketing for absolutely no reason. So the first question, how and who can debug this? The problem is that our code base has quite a bit of code, around 2 lakh lines of code at this stage. I have no idea. Okay, so 90% of that is node modules, I'm sorry. So a couple of methods do exist to sort of debug this. The first one is core dump. Just take a dump of whatever virtual machine or application is running on and analyze it from there. Security researchers love it, I'm pretty sure. The second one is something called MDB. Now, this is not a very viable option for a very simple reason, because this is a tool which is created by Joyent, which is sort of like, you can imagine it to be like a parent company for Node.js, and it only runs on one of their proprietary operating systems. So sad life there. And there is no debug. I'm not even going to go into why that is horrible. There is Perfmon, which is not that great, but it works on Linux events. You can get some sort of information from it, but for production, it's really, really slow. So, you know, I was having a chat with an engineer, like, you know, a senior engineer, and the first thing I hear is, are you lazy? Because back in their day, apparently, they used to read RAM with chips, which sadly I can't do because I have a very high-level system in my house. I'm just kidding. I don't. So what did I finally choose? I'm sorry for waffling there, but I went with flame graphs. And these look really pretty, like a lovely Diwali light there. And just to give you a quick idea of what it is, can anyone tell me what the y-axis represents? If anyone has worked on this? Exactly, so that's a stack frame. Excellent. Can anyone tell me what the x-axis means? Absolutely nothing, because it's node. So with that said, another thing, this width of the box you see is the time it was, the amount of time for which it was on the CPU. Just one thing. So that black box there, that means that's the process which is running when I took this flame graph. Yeah. So, you know, there's a simple controller call here which is calling two functions, you know, very simple sort of standard design practice. And that looks like this. I'm just getting a post request. There are some middlewares which I'm, you know, authentication, authorization, all of that jazz. And then I'm sending it for analysis, which is this lovely function. There are some problems with it. Can someone tell me what they are? Anyone from the crowd? Okay. Okay. I'm sorry. So the first object there, parse, that's basically a memory leak because I have a long-term object in a short-term context. And the second one is the classic post and pre-increment operators, which we learn in grade 9 while doing computer science. So JavaScript has this tendency of giving you something called an undefined at where something is out of range, instead of giving an index out of range exception, like the people who use Java or any other programming language for that matter. So very simply, it is just plus plus I from 0 to 11, I'm going pre-increment, undefined, and there's a memory leak. Now, we didn't really have good debugging practices and monitoring practices, right? And I was having a chat with some of my friends here, and there was a very valid point which was brought up. You can do all the logging in the world, but anyone can infiltrate if no one is looking. If someone has played Counter-Strike, they'll relate. So how do we monitor it? And the first question is, how do we create those pretty looking Diwali lights I call flame graphs? We can create a heap dump, which is all of the objects in the memory. And then I can just throw it in dev tools and see it from there. Very simple process. You cannot create it in production though, because it requires twice the amount of memory your system is currently running on. So we had to think with this in mind, and how did we do that? So Node has a lovely event attachment function called process.on, where you can attach to native Linux or Nix-based signals. The first one is SigUser2. There is also SigUser1, which are by definition not used by any processes. And then you can just get the heap dump package, and you can give this command. Now, if anyone has worked in DevOps or has managed a server, writing kill in prod sounds like, no, I'm not going to do that, because I like what I'm doing at this company. Let's just go to the man page for this, and it says, the kill utility sends a signal to the process. The first thing is just terminate or signal a process. So we are signaling a process, not killing it. Please add the dash s. And another thing which you should keep in mind is just restart the process before it locks you out. Because at one of my companies where we had a memory leak, we were logged out of our production clusters because we weren't able to SSH. The SSH daemon didn't have enough memory to basically decrypt our credentials properly. And for those of you who don't really like using separate packages, as I think so happens at large companies, there are these two lovely sort of properties on process.memory usage, which is a function native in Node. I don't remember the compatibility, but I think so it is 5.4 above. The RSS, or the resident set size, is the total memory used by all packages. And who can tell me what the heap is? Anyone? Anyone like to take a short, like a quick sort of one-line description of what the heap is? That's the stack. That's different. So the heap is the total memory for all the objects. The one thing which I would like you to know is that heap versus stack, the argument which we have in any other programming language, is not the same in JavaScript. For one reason, because it is JavaScript. Before we move on, a couple of things here which we should keep in mind while developing applications. Proper memory debugging practices and proper monitoring practices, so you know where your code is not functioning like it is supposed to. The second one is, I would say, a lovely juxtaposition for who I am as a person, a very talkative gentleman, and a bit. So I have a very simple route here, which just does a status for 200 and sends some JSON response. For any normal engineer, this would be like around 3 lines of logs. But for someone like me, it is this. Most of it is just for fun. I'm not sure why I do it. The second thing which I want to talk about is, who has used Winston here? You've used Winston. Okay, so how do you like it? Good, bad, horrible, very bad. All right. So what Winston does is, for those of you who have not used it before, you send it logs, and it's going to automatically upload it to your servers, whatever logging server or platform you have configured, which is great. But not for the application. Why? Because you're opening a new socket. And as we know, Node.js is a single-threaded, event-based, driven I/O system. So it means that if you open a new socket, you're basically compromising your business logic or the amount of memory or space your application has to run on. So the average latency was around 400 milliseconds for something as simple as that, which is literally just stringifying a JSON object. Out of which 328 milliseconds went for just sending it to the production server. So this is bad. This is bad. Now, in order to refine this process, we need to think about what is the point of logging. The point of logging for a developer, at least, or an engineer, is you get the data, you have the payload, you have the stack, so you can replay everything like it was happening when the application crashed or out on you. Now, why Winston was an overkill for us is because your business logic is not responsible for sending logs to your production server. Simply, the amount of complexity involved is just not worth it. And just to summarize all of transport, it is sending the it through the transport where it is stored in a database or whatever have you. And you know, application should be responsible for sending them, not processing them. So the better method is write it to stdout, a lovely console.log. And then pipe it to another process, which is again very simple, and you can achieve nirvana. I'm just kidding, don't try that. With that in mind, the second thing which you should keep in mind is control verbosity. So when I say verbosity, don't keep on waffling like I do for some reason. Just see the amount of logging you need in a separate environment. For example, in testing, you might want everything which is happening in the application. In staging, you would only want the errors probably, because you don't really care about the warnings. I mean, who does? And in production, again, probably the errors or the fatal exits, something along those lines. So control it. Now, how do you control verbosity in production in real time? So if I see that, you know, my 500 errors are spiking through the roof, how do I change the verbosity so that I can get everything I need to replay the thing which is happening? And this is the question you have, that how will you interface this? How will you make it, how will you bake this into the application such that you can change it right on the go? For that, we use management routes, which are basically, for example, imagine there are two routes, post management log and management health. What I do, I send a simple post request, and I just send the parameter there with which I want to change it. Like, for example, I want to go from info to trace or from trace to info, so on and so forth. And in the health, I can get how my external services are working. For example, how is my Postgres database doing? Or how is that lovely Redis cluster going? But this doesn't scale, because imagine if you have like a clustered environment with around 40 nodes, how will you go about doing this on every single machine? And the first thing which comes to mind is, how can I automate this? Because, you know, a good engineer automates anything which takes more than 10 seconds with a shell script. So for that, I will be introducing console. How many of you have heard of, at least, something called a service mesh or a service framework? Okay, all right, so excellent. So for those of you who do not know what a service mesh is, imagine it to be like a net which interlinks all of every service which is going on, which is similar or isomorphic, in if I had to be really professional at a conference. So what console will do is that it is going to give you something called reactive configurations. Now imagine I have a backend server and I want to deploy 10 bits or 10 instances of that server, and I want my front end to use just one DNS, because, you know, things can go down. You want like a DNS name based approach, because that is a lot simpler as opposed to going every node by name. The second thing it gives you is, as I said, reactive configuration. So reactive means that I'll react to something. If someone slaps me, I'm going to react. If someone cracks a joke, I'll probably won't. So that means that whenever the configuration file changes, I will update my application. I am going to reload the configuration file and start from there, which is very simple. Again, we'll be using the process.onNirvana moment for signal hang up, and imagine you have a configuration store like Redux or something, just reload the configuration there. And there's a very simple code piece I wrote. Of course, don't use this in prod, because this is going to give you memory leak, but you get the idea here. Now, the benefits, of course, are multifaceted. You can control whatever you need, whenever you need. You're not wasting a lot of bandwidth on logging. And whoever is monitoring for you is probably having, you know, a peace of mind, because you don't have to look through thousands of lines of logs for a simple request. Now, the episode 3 is probably the last one here, which deals with data security and cryptography. Now, I was employed for a project which was written in PHP. Can I get a cheers for PHP here, please? As I thought. So it had insecure authentication code. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean this. And probably Valakar is going to kill me for showing this to everyone. There's an MD5 happening in a production environment. This is Cake PHP for the PHP fans here. Lovely framework. And the bigger problem, which I, as someone who likes to sort of tell people about things, is that you're learning Node, you're learning JavaScript, you Google something, you go online, and you see that, okay, this is the way how you can store passwords, how you can update passwords, how you can create a very simple forgot password flow. They don't cover it properly because that's a huge barrier. Think about it. If I can get access to a token which changes your password, it is as good as changing, as good as having your password. Think about it. Because then I can change it to whatever I want instead of probably brute forcing on my GPU. So the usual flow is you get a request, you send a request, send an email, click on the link, and magic. The first problem here, as I think so many of us have talked about, is predictable tokens. Don't have something which is sequential, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the next token, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is not good, please. They can figure out how they work, and they can keep on replaying it for random users. The second one is non-volatile tokens, which do not expire after use. I have seen this in production applications where I can literally use the same token again and again and again. So I can forge a request, basically. So there's a better way. Generate a random string. And how many of you know what HMAC is? So you can imagine it to be like a hash with a password, which I can change with the password. Just use a random string, and for the key, use the current password which you've stored in the database. What's going to happen is that you won't have to delete it, because upon a successful reset, the password in the database changes, which makes the token by default not valid. Now, why did I bring this up? I'm sure most of you can't see what is happening, but the first request URL is HTTP. And what I'm going to show you next is going to blow your mind. We are transmitting live credentials over a simple HTTP connection. Great. Why? Why? And then it is also sending me a cookie, which I can store in my system. Let's take a look at that cookie. You can't again see it probably. The user data option looks very interesting here. So I tried to decode it, failed. And this is what it stores. The username and the password, clear as day. So a man in the middle attack is very easy. And my first response to seeing this was this. Right? So just to recap, whatever tutorials you follow online are probably not designed for production. So you would want to read about the package or the library you're using while building a system. And with that said, thank you so much for listening to me blabber for half an hour on a topic. Any questions from anyone? Yeah. Yes, I've tried Bcrypt. What did I suggest for encrypting passwords? No, so that was HMAC. That was for resetting passwords. Bcrypt is, again, so that's actually a very nice point there. How many of you know what Bcrypt is? How does it work? Can anyone tell me very quickly? More or less. Yeah, so what it does is that in security, there is something called a timing attack. Which means that I can see the amount of time or the amount of processor resource some process is taking, and then I can decrypt it. What Bcrypt does is that it gives you sort of like a way to define the amount of time it takes for the hash to sort of be generated for you. You can control that with something called a cost factor or a costing function. Read about it. It's actually very interesting for those of you who want to use something like Bcrypt. You should also look into Argon2, which won the password hashing competition, I think, so last year. Anything else?
Anybody else who has the questions? Anyone in the audience? Yep. Thanks, right. Shreyans. So with that, we'll move to Flash Talks. Flash Talks are... So the Flash Talks format is a quick five-minute sessions. And for that, first we have Gopinath, who will be talking about introduction to GraphQL. Gopinath, if you can start the session. And I would request Nandita, Ramesh, and Mohammed Yasin to be ready, because Flash Talks, we want to finish it quick and not waste any time between the switching.
USB, right? USB. Okay. That should be on the side, I think. What is the problem?
Have you ever tried connecting it?
Yeah, it was working once.
Can we keep your talk to the next?
Yeah, okay. Next.
I mean, we're having a technical issue. Nandita, can you join in?
Resolution is a little. I can't get to.
Slide.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Nandita. I've been a developer at ThoughtWorks for about a year now, and if you're somebody relatively new at the scene like me, this talk is going to be about stuff that I've learned and picked up over this past 1 year of being a developer. If you're a developer, you would frequently be using some source control tool like, say, Git or Mercurial. And it's really easy for you to say you will commit your code later. But what I've learned in the past is don't do that. Check in your code frequently, like make frequent commits. And even more importantly, once you make a commit, make sure to check in. But obviously, don't check in broken code. Once you have a proper of a functional code, even if it's not fully complete, make sure to check in. Check in early, check in often. Some software guiding principles that I've learned would be not to repeat yourself. In the sense, don't write repetitive code or don't write redundant code. And these three principles, I think they kind of smoothly interweave. In the sense, don't write repetitive code. It also helps you keep things simple. For you to not write repetitive code, always write small functions that could be reused as and when needed. So you have a single point of control and coherence. Also, it's really easy when you're an enthusiastic developer, it's really easy to think about a feature that might be needed 6 months down the lane and work on it. But one thing that I think we've always seen, especially in the agile world and in the agile philosophy, is changes are very frequent, and in keeping up with the agile philosophy of being open and open towards changes and not hesitant about making changes. Don't presume that things might be needed in the future and write code that you don't currently need. So don't write code that you don't need. And to reiterate the other two things, keep it simple. This is another principle that is followed. And so I've heard this come up in like a lot of discussions. Just because you can solve a problem with technology, you don't have to throw technology at a problem if there is a simpler non-tech solution to that problem. And that, like, from a philosophical perspective, I believe in that. And also, the other thing would be to write really simple code in terms of not using very illegible or names that make no sense, or following consistent naming conventions throughout your code. That would really help in keeping it simple. And okay, my slides got messed up a little. Okay, so something that got left out of the slide. So another thing that that comes in really useful is writing tests. And we at ThoughtWorks follow a principle called test-driven development, wherein you write tests for every code line of code you write. How TDD works is you write a failing test case, and you write just enough code to make that test case pass. And once you get a green on that test case, you add more test cases, and you loop through this process, and you extend your test coverage. That would be TDD. And for those of you who are more interested in stuff like this, you can read about it on martinfowler.com or refersourcemaking.com. That's it from me. Thank you.
Thanks, Nandita. Next up, we have Ramesh, who will be talking about refreshing of tokens, followed by Mohammed Yasin, who's going to present about Kotlin.
Hey everyone, this is Ramesh, and I work as a developer in ThoughtWorks. Okay, okay, it works. Okay, I'm going to talk about like how you're going to refresh your tokens when you're like. So why we need tokens? Like we had so many talks today about like security, right? Like this is kind of like one step towards your one step towards your more securable app by implementing the token-based authentications. Like, there are so many token-based authentications now available. And they may like OAuth and YDZ that we have. And OAuth is something like, it's an authorization methodology which is used based on tokens. And then the next one is like OIDC, which is OpenID Connect, which is also based on tokens again, which is actually written over the OAuth, and which is actually for authentication rather than authorization. So these two are mostly used in mobile and web applications to like increase the level of one more level of security. And here you can see like how it normally like actually it's very simplified form of like how the token-based authentication happens. Like early days, we used to send user ID and password to our server from the client, like browser, and then like the browser authenticates you as a legit user, and then like it sends a session cookie to the browser, and then like after that, like you're keeping on conversing with your server based on your session. But where you are contacting with another one server, auth server, and this that will return you a auth token, which is like used for the following conversations with your resource server where you have actual resources. So And those tokens will be like having a very limited like validity. And like in the previous talk, like Sudhanshu was saying, like having your like non-volatile tokens are like very much vulnerable. So we mostly have the tokens which are like very less lifetime. So here, so we have seen that like we'll be having the tokens with very less validity. So what happens is like when you're coding or like when you're developing the applications, you had the overhead of like refreshing your tokens whenever it gets expired. So that's why like this talk came in. And actually like in most of the times, like in the recent times, we use a library called Axios, which is used for like connecting to your servers, like which is like a client, HTTP client for you, where you will be like connecting your servers and like getting the response from it. So what I have done is like I have written a small library for it, and then like which will be taking care of like creating a token and refreshing the token whenever that particular token gets expired, and it will like add it to your every request. So that is that library has been written in TypeScript, and it is actually done by using the interceptor concept, which is available in Axios. Actually, what the interceptor does is like for every each and every call like which you are sending, both requests and responses are intercepted, and you can do whatever you want. So we are just using that methodology, and then like we are like whenever your request gets expired by like 401 or 403 or something like, so that like it just intercepts and like it will go and refresh your token, and then like it'll add it automatically. And this is it. This is how you will be like adding it and using it. The first one, like you can use this. It's an it's exposed as an npm package. You can install this particular package in your application by using like npm I Axios token refresher. And just to like, if you want to have the auto refreshing of tokens to be enabled for your Axios instance, you just need to call this function which is coming from this library with the Axios instance, or like you can just send the global instance also, but that global instance will be having the whole instance will be having the power of like refreshing the token. So like I'm just recommending you to like create the separate instance for you, so that like that particular instance will be having this power of refreshing the tokens and attaching it. And the next one is the function which is really doing the refresh. Actually, like this library does not refresh the token for you. It just calls your function, so that like because like each and every auth provider will be having their own mechanism of refreshing their tokens. So that's why like it's given to the even like the consumer to decide like how to refresh. So this will be delegated. And these are the options, like when you want to call it as an expired token, and like what is the delay you want to have, and those kind of options can be given here. And just like after you have done it, like you can use that client to get your resource. It'll automatically like plug in your token whenever you make a call to your server. And this is the Git repository and like npm URL for the package. And that's it. Yep. Thank you.
Thanks, Ramesh. Then we'll follow it up with Mohammed Yasin, who will be presenting about introduction to Kotlin. And after this, we'll have Ramesh Subramanian giving a small thought-provoking session on thinking beyond technical.
Good evening. I am Mohammed Yasin. I am a developer with ThoughtWorks. I am going to briefly talk about Kotlin. So how many of you heard about Kotlin? Okay. So I see few college students already confused with what languages to learn. To add confusion, I'm going to introduce another language, Kotlin. So Kotlin was developed by one of the premier corporation called JetBrains. So some of you might have used ReSharper or IntelliJ IDEA. So JetBrains is the creators of Kotlin. Kotlin was introduced in 2011, but it was not getting enough attraction until Google made it is the official language or official language for developing Android applications. Once Google announced this one, Kotlin came into limelight. So why you need to learn Kotlin? So Kotlin works on JVM. It's one of the languages. There are many languages that uses JVM. Kotlin is also based on JVM. So challenges, to make it comparison easier, I'm going to compare it with Java. So what are all the challenges you'll face with Java? So it's like imperative style of coding. So you need to write lot of code, lot of boilerplate codes, and it's like an imperative, and it does not support functional paradigm. So Kotlin is both object-oriented and functional. It supports both paradigms. And you have to write lot of boilerplate code in Java. So I was a C# developer from the beginning. I'm having around 8 years experience in C#. But when I want to learn Java, so when I start writing Java code, I need to write lot of code in Java. So if you compare it with C# has lot of new features. In Java, it doesn't have the new features. So I need to write lot of boilerplate codes. So when I was looking into the alternatives, Kotlin came into the rescue. Like Kotlin was very similar to C#. So you'll have all the benefits of C#. So it's a better C# for the JVM. So these are all the JVM languages out there in the market. So most of you might have heard about Scala and Clojure and Kotlin and Groovy. So how many of you heard about Clojure language? So these are all the four languages works on JVM. So we have covered this one. So this is the GitHub stars for Kotlin. It's like it's around 27,850 stars. So it's pretty much a popular language now. And this is the Stack Overflow survey on 2019. So Kotlin is in the fourth place. Last year it was in the second place. Now it moved to fourth. So as I said, JetBrains is the creators of Kotlin. So Kotlin's tool support, you have excellent support for IntelliJ IDEA, and in Android Studio, you have excellent support, Eclipse, and Visual Studio Code, you have support for working with Kotlin. So give you some example of how powered the Kotlin is. This is just a small class, data class called student. It has three variables, three fields, name, age, and rank. So if you want to create the same thing in Java, you need to write around 25 to 30 lines to achieve all these functionalities. So this single line will create all the getters and setters. It will override a hash code. It will have override string, all the functionalities. So if you want to create any classes just to hold data without, you can also have a behavior. If you want to have a data transfer objects, DTO objects, you don't need to write a lot of boilerplate code. This single line of code is enough to give you all the functionalities that normal data classes you'll have. So I'm going to talk briefly about some of the Kotlin features. I'm not going to deep. These are some of the features available, like type inference, string templates, null safety, smart cast, destructuring, extension methods, data classes, default arguments, named arguments, and when is an equivalent for switch, and FP is the capability to do functional programming. So these are all the features that are available, that are not available in Java language. If you see, type inference is not there, string templates is not there, and most importantly, the null safety. So you'll be a classic null pointer exception. Whoever has worked with Java know they will be struggling with this null pointer exceptions. So as the language itself provides safety from null, so it will not allow any null value to be assigned to any non-nullable variable. And smartcast, restructuring, these extension methods, Kotlin has used extensively the extension methods to come up with a standard library. So they have the standard library that supports a lot of utility functions. Most of their list and common operations on list are extension methods only. So C Sharp has these extension methods from the beginning. So this is one of the cool features of Kotlin. So that's it.
Thanks, Yasin. Thanks for that. Next up, we have Ramesh Subramanian, who's going to give us a thought-provoking session, a quick.
Thank you, everyone. I'm Ramesh Subramanian. I'm a journalist turned programmer turned entrepreneur. So that's a weird combination, basically. So thank you for giving us the opportunity for HasGeek and everyone present here. So, yeah, I'm a programmer as well as an entrepreneur. So I'm here to share just one single thought. See, how many of you are here are developers? Quad core developers? And how many of you are from ThoughtWorks? And how many are not from ThoughtWorks? And how many of you are from Coimbatore? How many of you are not from Coimbatore? Okay, thank you. So, how many of you are actually, so sorry for asking this question, it sounds silly but still relevant. So, how many of you are actually JavaScript developers? Okay, the next question, you know, how many of you are not JavaScript developers? Can you tell me how many of you are here with less than 1 year of experience with JavaScript? Not at least, that is, I don't have more than 1 year working with JavaScript. Within 2 years? Within 3 years? There's one thing I really wanted to ask you is the next question is much more important. How many of you are right, another question. How many of you have contributed a single line of code to a open source project? Except speakers and ThoughtWorks employees, again. None? Pretty well. Okay, so, you know, may I ask you why? So, I've been enjoying the talk from Sranesh, actually. So, Sranesh, and Weird Panda, I was not able to find it in Twitter, so otherwise we would have called you Weird Panda. But the talk was so amazing that, you know, some of the tools, you know, I find it, okay, I know it personally, but some of the tools I really do not know. But when he was actually talking about it, he was trying to have an engagement, basically. You know what the word called engagement, right? So the engagement is what actually a speaker is actually looking for from a perspective. So that is actually what makes a programmer, an excellent programmer from an average programmer. And engagement is something that is actually what lacks in Coimbatore as well. I'm here to talk about Coimbatore and the developers from Coimbatore. And the talk itself is about when he was asking, okay, I'm not here to give a flash talk, but even the topic itself came as a flash because after seeing the engagement. So I was thinking, okay, why we are not having this kind of an engagement except in ThoughtWorks? I think ThoughtWorks is having an excellent, amazing community, and they have a regular meetups, and they are conducting it on a regular perspective. But apart from coming out of the artworks, this is actually not happening, which is kind of a proving kind of a detrimental to the entire Coimbatore ecosystem, especially the development ecosystem, not just JavaScript, but for other languages also. So why? Why that engagement should be there beyond? That is, see, you are a good developer. You are developing, you are working, or you're working on your own, or working for some other company. Yeah, great. But what is happening beyond that? What actually works? What actually really we make a contribution, either within the ecosystem, within a company, within a region, or in a global environment? For example, taking an open source project and contributing to an open source project? No, it's not happening. When events like this happens, right, people come, speakers from all over the place, you know, come and then share us their experiences and their, you know, knowledge with us. But apart from this one day, what are we doing for 364 days? Is there something that we can do? Can we do something? You know, I take this forum as an opportunity to ask you this question. I came up here just to ask this question. Can we do something? How do I know? See, okay, in our company, we have a team of Node.js developers. We keep on talking about it, though I'm a journalist and other kind of stuff, I'm interested. I know what is Axios, what is a promise, what is a JWT token, and all the protocols about OAuth. Yeah, I do know about it. I do know the best practices in all those stuff. I know what is Colton also, right? We work with international communities also, but is it sufficient that we work within our own company itself? Is it okay that if we contain the knowledge within our own company itself? So can't we have a community engagement, an engagement that actually helps us to learn together, grow together, and work together? Can we? Yes? Can we do something about it? Yes? Okay, so here is just one task. Okay, this is my email ID, ramesh@cartrabbit.io. I'll leave this email ID with them as well. So just send me your thoughts, what we can do, and we can try and, you know, conduct continuous sessions and, you know, open sessions that actually either in ThoughtWorks premises or some other premises also, yeah? Because in ThoughtWorks, the problem with the ThoughtWorks is that you guys are at the very end of it. Okay, but you're doing amazing job. I was there for some of the meetings, and I'm perfectly, you know, amazed. But it actually, you cover on a diverse topics. But I'm talking as a development as a whole, right? So take down my email ID. My email ID is ramesh@cartrabbit.io. Please do share your thoughts, what we can do, and if you can, send it to us. And then we also run on another community, and I think Google probably will be able to talk. I think Google's... Skip this? Okay, since Google wanted to skip this. See, we have an amazing community for startups. It's called Coimbatore Startups. How many of you know Coimbatore Startups? There is a group. It's only entrepreneur-oriented group, but we can also accommodate tech enthusiast as well. You can come to the meetings. It happens on every second Saturday at PAZ Tech. Okay? It happens on every second Saturday of every month on a regularly at PAZ Tech. You can also come there and then express it. But for the development community, I'm asking you whether, you know, when we can do something and conduct something on a regular basis to share, learn, and grow together. Right? Ramesh@cartrabbit.io. Thank you. Thank you, Cassie.
Thanks, Ramesh. That was very inspiring. Next up, we have Arun Kumar Krishnamurthy, who will be talking about a little pieces of tech. It's also worthy to mention that it was Arun Kumar who was the person behind pushing us to do an event here. So he has been coordinating from the beginning. So thanks, Arun, for that.
So if all smart employees start a company, then all the companies have to put up, we are hiring, a poster out there, and then start doing hiring. So yeah, we, every startup companies, we do have great ideas, but in, when you want to scale up, then we lack of talent, and then we go for, we are hiring stuff. So just some of the slides where I presented for HasGeek Pune, and I'm not going to bore you with this slides out there, but I wanted to fundamentally talk about basic design patterns and architecture that is fundamental principles of any solution architecture. I'm not going to bore you with that as well. But only thing is, there are foundations, because the JavaScript especially has got lack of standards. See, I started my career with C++ and Java. So Java has got a wonderful standards and specifications which are regulated, right? You know what specifications you need to use it. And then you start using the framework like Spring and Hibernate and all that stuff, and then that come on the way. But there is a clear specification for an enterprise application, right? So in an enterprise application, be it in .NET architecture or in Java, you have got a very well layered architecture. And there are specifications and standards that you wanted to assemble and then put them together and then create a particular enterprise application or an integrated enterprise applications too. But unfortunately, in JavaScript world, because it's pretty open-ended and open to the web community, we are lacking a bit of standards, except for Mozilla Development Network and a few other things who are driving their own JavaScript ECMA standards and all that stuff. But we are humongously crowded with a lot of framework. Whenever you want to use a framework, we always go to Google and then see comparisons between this framework and that framework, which is popular, that is popular, and all that stuff. So we are going to live with this because the web standard is going to be open for lifetime, right? It's based, JavaScript is the language which the browser understands, and the browser is going to be free forever. So we will have this open community. No one is going to buy that like an Oracle and then dictate the terms. So in that segment, whether someone will say AngularJS is good, or Angular is good, or React Native is good. So we will be dealing with these kind of problems on a day-to-day basis. So we kind of started 2 years back. We had to choose a particular technology. I was strong in Java, worked on .NET as well, and Python. But when we wanted to choose a particular technology and solution, it's not about what we know. It's more about what is appropriate for a particular solution or problem domain. So when it has come to a product-based organizations or a product development, one of the key thing is about making it customizable or configurable stuff, right? Predominantly, when you go with the relational structure, you'll always, when you want to have an extended content type. See, when it is statically data typed, like, oh, because once I learned from, moved from static type Java to a dynamically typed JavaScript, now then the static type TypeScript has come, right? So I started liking JavaScript because it's dynamic, and now people say that the modern stuff is more about TypeScript, which is more type friendly. Maybe that is for those people who are bored with JavaScript and want to move to something like a Java, but I was not bored with Java, but wanted to move from Java to a JavaScript, and then now they call it as TypeScript, which is more like type safety and all that stuff. But yes, so we went with a microservices-based architecture because nowadays microservices allows you to divide and conquer. So previously, we have one monolithic application. We vertically layer them and data access layer, service layer, and then the other stuff. Java gives you like a web fragments and other things. So you put it in, say, the bar, a web fragment, and then do it. Even for .NET world, you have other components that you can assemble them and then put together. But when you wanted to talk about distributed deployment, scale them independently, and move some of the pieces to cloud and other stuff, microservices in a way kind of helps us to kind of have distributed and then scale it. So that is one of the things. I just want to take a case study like an education institutions, where there are different types of education institutions that are there, whether it is engineering or arts and science, or it's going to be school or K-12 market. So you got a different schema for each and every type of institution. So underlying problem domain itself is schema-less. So you can't go with relational data structure and then try to create a particular content type and then document types and then create a data model which is relational. And there comes JavaScript, which is going to be coming handy because JavaScript as a document is schema-less by itself, right? So that's when we chose a document-based databases. And so as a solution architect, you need to evaluate all the pros and cons of different technologies and framework and software that is available to you. In this problem domain, in this context, schema-less, document-based database will hold good. But it is going to be like, you know, in an education, there are a lot of graph models that are there. Which student is enrolled to which courses, who's teaching to whom, and then what programs are offered by what departments, and in what timeline. So it's more like a property graph that comes in play. So there, a graph model will help you out in actually modeling your complete graph structure. And visualizations have now become very popular. So now you have a graph visualization of your whole institution. So in how you want to play it out with it. So you have a nodes between them. You have a timeline, because I belong to this particular batch, 2018-19. And in that particular timeline, I am associate and I am enrolled to this particular course. During that particular timeline, this is the faculty who's teaching me. Or these are the courses that you're enrolled. So you put it all together in a different way, in a graph model will come handy for you to collaborate. I want to take a content. I create a content. I want to share it with these nodes or these particular graphs who are associated with this one. Right? So in that scenario, a graph model will come handy. So it's up to you to kind of choose the right data model and then fit it into your overall solution architecture. And the next thing is about your service layer and other business logic layer, which is, again, whether you want to choose Node.js, Express.js, or you want to choose a Python-based Django stuff, or a Flask server which is running there, or a Java REST services, or .NET web APIs. So again, if you choose like a microservices-based architecture, you are left with a choice. You can go ahead with simple microservices on one single platform. And tomorrow, if that doesn't work out, you can choose that microservice alone to move to a different application technology or framework. So in that way, your whole microservices are integrated through APIs and service bus. So you'll be able to deal with them. The front end, again, you are going to divide it based on what framework you want to do it. So there are micro front ends. If you wanted to have an integrated dashboard assembling UI from different microservices, you can go with micro front end. Or you can go with microservices or single page web application, which can cater to it. So other thing is about your cross-platform mobile application, because mobile-based application is very much required. So we have chosen Apache Native Script. So it was infant, but it was fairly doing well compared to the other Ionic frameworks or other stuff, because Apache Native Script gives you Angular and React support. Again, it is an Apache project, so we went ahead with that when we compared with Flutter or Apache Native Script or Ionic and other stuff, or React Native. And that is helping us a lot in terms of reusability of code. So you've got an Angular frontend or HTML stuff, you reuse that code in your mobile-based stuff. So we have got a cross-platform mobile application which is running on Apache Native Script. So one of the things that I want to iterate here is think big in JavaScript. So people always teach in education institutions or in some other like Java or .NET or Python as a general purpose programming language. But with all the tooling that is there for product engineering as well as for development, JavaScript has now matured for us to create a wonderful full stack enterprise structure and build an enterprise grade application. So with that, I'll just close this, wrap this stuff. So we are using KeyCloak, OpenAuth, kind of central authentication stuff, thanks to ThoughtWorks, Technology Radar also. They are also adopting KeyCloak stuff. So we do cross-check with that. We are still using AngularJS, by the way. We are a product company. We can't go with keep on changing the Angular framework that is there. Because it's microservices, some of them maybe we will move to TypeScript. I'm happy to work with dynamic JavaScript and AngularJS. So how many of you are still using AngularJS? 1.x, I mean.
Oh yeah,
okay, we are trending then. It's okay, thank you.
Thanks, Arun. We have one last flash talk, probably should have been the first one, by Gopinath. You have to do it from here.
So hi everyone, my name is Gobinath. I actually work in banking domain, and so first of all, thanks to JSFU for organizing this event. And one more thing that is special about this event is like I am an alumni of this GID college, and so that's another thing to add. And so today's talk is about short intro to GraphQL. Anybody have used or came across GraphQL? Yeah. So why GraphQL? Like before starting GraphQL, like I want to talk about like what graphs actually. So graphs are like, fundamentally graph is just a data structure. So it's like when data goes more dynamic, right? So you have to handle much more better. These days, the data was more like less complex, and nowadays data is getting heavy. For example, e-commerce and social networks like Facebook. So every day the data is more complex, and the data gets more dynamic. So in order to handle that, you have to have a good data structure. That's where the graph comes in. And I will provide some cases like where like graph-oriented data is coming into help. Like for example, Audi is using a graph-based data model for their e-tron car, and New York Times entire front-end page is designed based on graphs. And even for Airbnb, it is like they have a heavily complex system, so they handle their data with graphs. And so that's the use cases. And so basically, GraphQL, just like React, GraphQL was developed at Facebook. So why did they need GraphQL? So what is GraphQL does actually? So which means that at some point, Facebook grown into a big system, and the UI got very complex. And to handle the UI complexity, they started to make the UI into a simple component so they can easily like manage their UI. And so they broke down the UI into small components so they can manage their UI easily. So that can be developer friendly as well. Likewise, so far we have been, for web applications, we have APIs, right? And even for API, so whenever you want to have kind of talk to a front end, you will have multiple APIs talking to each other. And when the system grows much larger, you will have multiple APIs and multiple endpoints. So again, Facebook came up with a solution so they can unify their API and provide a single endpoint. So they can just use that one endpoint and develop a client based on that. So that's why GraphQL was designed. So like this can be, you will feel overwhelmed, like why I have to learn a new tool like GraphQL while I already have multiple tools like Redux and Node, Express, so many things are there. So once you get the concept, right, you will actually start using GraphQL much more. So without much talk, I will go into demo. I was just so time for to show some code. So this is like a simple schema where you will create a schema based on the model. So
Yeah, this is just a simple database model. We have one ID, which is a primary key, and we have one post. That's just a simple database model. So for that, when we use GraphQL, first we will create a schema, which is an exact model of that, which is based on the database model. Yeah, so you build a schema, which is built on top of DB model, and where. And on top of that schema, you build a resolver, which will actually query and talk to a DB. Yeah, so here you have two things, query, mutation. Query is like just like in CRUD, you have create, read, update, delete, right? So query will handle the read operations, and update, delete, and create will be handled by mutation. So this is the server.js file where we will bring the schema and resolvers together. And you can see where I am defining the server, constant server equal to new Apollo server. There I am bringing in the schema and resolvers. So that's how it will set up a basic server, and it will create a new API for my DB. So I'm going to just run the server and see what happens. So it is just running the server and client together. So server is listening to the port. And it is starting the React client app. So we just have a simple text field, and we have a button to post it. So it will call the DB model, and then schema, and then resolver. So once we post an text to the box, and it will actually send the text to the schema. So as you can see, it is just executing an insert statement into the DB. So that's basically how GraphQL works. And actually, I don't have much time to go into detail. And so this is just to give you an idea about why and how we use GraphQL. So once you get the concept, you will actually have a much more easy developer experience. So this is like one more utility that comes along with the GraphQL Apollo, where you can have a playground and actually start interacting with the API. So I don't think you can see it actually much clear because the rendering is not fine. So this is like a query where you can query the DB directly from the API.
Thanks, Gopinath. That was really helpful. Those who are interested to know about GraphQL, you can connect with Gopinath offline and take it forward. Up next, we have Tejas. Tejas is from Hyderabad. He's going to talk more about state management and how it helps any application. Thanks. Over to you, Tejas.
Yep. Thanks, Arun. Hello. My name is Tejas. I work at Graminer, where we mainly narrate data insights as stories. So today, I'll be covering on how to use finite state machines for managing front-end state. But before that, a quick survey. How many of you are familiar with finite state machines? If you are a student, you probably might have covered UML diagrams. just like flow charts. So those nice looking flow charts are just not a theoretical, completely theoretical subject. They can actually be useful in the in management of front-end state. And to illustrate that and the problem that we will be solving, I'll start with taking the example as we go on building a 2D side-scroller game. Anyone recognize this game? Not Super Mario. It's Mega Man. We wouldn't be building this, but it'll be very similar from the feature standpoint. So firstly, we start with handling the game player's input. So we have a simple function called handle input. And whenever the button B is pressed, we set the image as jump. So B is to jump the player. And now, if you see the previous one, the player can only jump for one instance. Like, so what's the issue with this piece of small code? The problem is we are not building a Flappy Bird game, so there is no air jumping. So once the input press is recognized as the B press, we should put a Boolean flag and ensure that further press of the button B, the player doesn't keep jumping in the air. So when if the user keeps on pressing the button B, the player also should be still be jumping only once. The rest of the button B presses should be discarded. So we add a simple Boolean flag called isJumping and set the graphics image as jump image only if the player is not jumping. So we can move on to the next requirement. The next requirement would be to, whenever the user presses the down button, we have to duck the player if the player is on the ground. And on release of the down arrow, the player should stand. So how do we write the code for that? We start with one more if statement and say that if the input is pressed down and the player is not jumping, we set the graphics as duck, which means that if the player is standing, we basically set the graphics as duck image. And on release of the down arrow button, we set the graphics image as stand, resetting the image. And if you think this is correct code, you're basically wrong. There's still a bug in this. Any tries, guesses? Okay. So when so if we take the previous the first feature, which is jumping, and when we are jumping, if the user releases the arrow down arrow, then while the player is jumping, the image is set to standing in between the jump. So how do we again try to fix this? We add one more flag saying only jump if the player is already not jumping and if the player is not ducking. So, and we can keep doing this. If we now want to add a dive attack, which is a ground pound, we can add one more if condition in on press of the down when jumping, saying that set the graphics as image dive. So that's one more feature addition. And that again breaks something. So this time, it is when if I am doing the diving, so when I'm jumping from the height, and if I press the button B again and again, I keep on air jumping. So again, I need to introduce a new flag called ease diving and keep on adding more and more flags to the code. And this is the common situation that we all will be in whenever we start with simple if statements. And remember, we haven't yet even started writing code for shooting feature. So keeping this aside, how are state charts going to be very much relevant in solving this? Before even understanding what a state chart is, we need to understand what a state machine is. A state machine is basically a data structure or a container that has a set of states. It follows a few rules, which is like a machine can only be in one state at any point of time, and a machine takes a sequence of events as input. The way it works is it takes the input sequence of events as input, input plus current state, it will trigger, change the state of the application to the next state. So these might be some familiar UML diagrams that you might have studied, which is like start state, end state, a transition from one state to the other state. The other important thing in the practical applications is the usage of guards or conditions, because most of the practical applications will require conditional setting of states. Coming to the previous problem, we can actually rewrite the entire if statements code by taking a piece of paper and pen and jotting down the listing down all the states that the player could be in, which is standing, jumping, diving, and ducking. And there were few transitions between these states which are limited to this. So what's the difference between this and the previous one? So here, there is no air jumping. So if I have to create a feature like air jumping, I would have to add a self transition to the same jumping state on press of the button B, which doesn't exist in this. So this is how we have learned the state charts in academics. But let's try to write the same thing using code. And there are multiple ways to model this in the JavaScript code, but I'll start with something very similar, very familiar to us, which is the switch case statements. And remember, the switch case statement is something I would consider that as an abstract of if statements, because everything I can do in switch case statement, I can write it in basically if-else if statements again. But we'll be using switch case statements. So what are state charts now? They are basically the extension of state machines, which gives us powerful features to introduce the concepts like inheritance. We call here it as hierarchical states. And there will be more powerful concepts like handling parallel states and setting up a next state using conditions, which are called as guards, and activities, which are basically the actions that prolong till the end of the state. So these are the important concept when it comes to modeling it in real life applications. But we'll start with something very simple, without any of the state charts, and which is basically a state machine. So we refactor the entire previous code, the same handle input function, but with a switch case statement. We start with if the player state is standing and the input is B, then jump. Or else if the input is pressed down, then basically duck. So this piece of code is a lot more easy. Now, this is the same functionality as the previous one. But what's the real difference between the previous one and the current one? But before doing that, let's try to add one more feature of this, which is like shooting, which we thought of. We didn't do it in the last time's code. And see if adding a new feature here will actually break any of the previous code that we have written. So we already have the press B and press down while standing, our code written previously. Now we'll add the shooting condition, saying on enter, on press of enter, the player should basically shoot. So I just add one more if condition and I'm done. I don't need to worry about did this break in the jumping state or ducking state? What about diving state? Is this going to again break something else in the previous code that I have written? No, not at all. But the problems with this code is that shooting is something that gets done in all the states. So I have to keep repeating this same if-else if statement in all the jumping state and ducking state, because shooting is something that you could be doing in, during the entire any of the actions. So the problem, code repetition, and how do we reuse the code? This is where the state charts concept come, which is the hierarchical state. Something that is repeating across all the states is hints us that we can model it as a hierarchical state. So demystifying state machines code, how is this a big deal than the previous if-else statements? And it's basically a switch case statements that we have now, and previously we have if-else statements. So let's find out the differences. It's basically, we have this almost same looking code, but previously we have the input condition at the beginning of the function. And then we are doing something related to the state. And now we are reversing those statements. The simple difference is previously we are reacting to the events that we have and setting the next state. The current one, takes into account the account of the current state and also the input, and then sets the next state. What's the missing part is the current state. Great. State machines solve all our problems. So I was more like in this mood, trying to state machine all the code that I have seen or I have written in the past 1 or 2 months. And that is when I have realized that I could apply this to a dashboard. I work at Grammarner and we build a lot of dashboards. We end up building a lot of dashboards in the process of finding insights and then narrating them as stories. So one such dashboard is this. We have a multi-line chart and there were top filters and again a lot more parallel filters, tabs basically, and there were few more filters. I mean, basically a lot of filters for exploring the data. So here we have a set of regions, which are basically buttons, and every time a button is active, a line in the multi-line chart appears. So this looks like a simple one, but the requirement will be is a little tricky because we may end up with deselecting all the buttons in the right side, and that will show an empty chart. And why would a user would want to ever see an empty chart? So what we say is whenever we keep deselecting the buttons and we end up hitting the last active button, it shouldn't deselect itself and create an empty chart. It should basically select all the buttons that are there, thereby showing all the multi-lines. And in the same way, when we have all the buttons selected, we need to on click of a particular button, instead of deselecting it, it should basically select the only clicked button and rest of the ones will be unselected. So this more or less looks like this. So I keep selecting all the buttons and okay, I'm deselecting them. And click on any button should only activate that. Yeah. So if I have to write the same thing in pure logic, is again we can use a if statement here. I just went with a switch case. So it'll look almost like this, with the first condition saying if all buttons are active, activate the clicked button only, or else if the clicked button is the only active button, which is the last button, and I click on that button, instead of deactivating it, activate all the buttons. And in rest of the cases, just toggle the state of the button. So the first step in actually modeling a problem into a state chart or a state machine is to identify the states. And identifying states is something that we do not do when we write if-else statements. And this thing is actually the major advantage and the disadvantage of state machines. The advantage is that we get to do the upfront thinking, do something that we clearly avoid. We are introducing a design phase into the programming style. But that also means that we need to spend some time, and writing a if-else statement would actually seem very convenient. But let's try to identify the states. There were multiple possibilities in identifying the states. We have almost 6 buttons here. I'm not considering the previous and planned buttons. And each button has a on state and an off state, so that makes it 2^6 states. And we want to avoid a state where all the buttons are deselected, thereby avoiding a empty multi-line chart. So we can actually write this as a 2^6-1, 31 states, and create a finite state machine. Or we could create an abstraction over those 31 states and say that we only have 3 states. One is one button selected, the other is all buttons selected, the other is more than one button selected. Or the best is modeling the entire state chart as a one single state. So while during the process of identifying states, try to optimize to reduce the number of states that we'll be modeling. So I'll good luck with trying with a 31 state programming switch case statement. I wouldn't be covering that up. I will be mostly covering on the 3 states, which is I start with a starting state as all active buttons. On click of that, there is only one state that it can go to, which is make it only one button selected. And but when I'm in the one button selected, if I click on the active button that is selected, it basically goes to all active buttons. Or if I am selecting some other non-active buttons, I keep actually selecting them, and I get to a state of 1+ active buttons. And if I, from 1+ active buttons, if I keep selecting more and more buttons, I end up with all active buttons. That's a wrong thing. Or if I'm keep deselecting all the buttons, I basically end up in a one button. So that's it. That's still a state chart. We are using guards here. How do we model this in the programming? We can use switch case statements. I would like to avoid that. And use a better data structure, basically a dictionary. And it's a mapping between action, I mean, a state and a particular action, and what the action should be. So it's, the definition of action is the value. The action name, which could be like a click event or a change event or trigger event, any event. It could be a custom function, custom event that you have created in your own front-end JavaScript. So if you have to model the same thing, what we do is the state name is all region selected. On click of any button, we basically have this function that will define the side effects. Here, the side effects is to select only one button which was actually clicked. So event.target will give us the button that was clicked, and we only make that button as active, and rest of the buttons will be inactive. So all the side effects go into this. And in the same way, we can keep doing the same thing repeated. And how do we actually run the entire state machine? We create a function called interpreter, and every time a click event happens, this interpreter function gets called, and we take the current state into the state variable and dispatch an action, which is basically calling the function that is that was in the value of the event, and transition the state to the new state. So if I am in the all region selected, I get transitioned to the one region selected. And during the transitions, if I want to trigger any events, such as activating the previous and plan buttons, that is where this piece of code will handle. And all of this will give us a time travel logger, because I can get to, on every input event, I can get to see that, okay, I'm in this state, and this is the event, and this is the next state that I have gone to. So debugging this is very easy. So this is the one where I have added actually the DOM code that was required for it. But this is something that we have built by ourselves without using any library. And this is a finite state machine, because we do not have the hierarchy or concurrent states management system. And the most popular one these days is the XState, which actually provides all the concurrent states handling or hierarchy activities, all these concepts bundled into the nicely interfaced library called XState. The documentation is really good, and there are a ton of examples out there. The best thing that I have initially liked after writing this piece of code and started to use XState is here I have coupled the event and the behavior of the application, which is basically the action, tightly coupled. So what XState does is it simply goes in a declarative format and says that, okay, list down all your states. So here I have a current state. I can have current state, I mean, like state 1, state 2, state 3. And on particular event of on an event called input, you go to the next state. That's the simplest way to define. Here we haven't actually covered the syntax for the actions. So this is to introduce the library syntax. This is a simple example. What it basically does is it toggles a particular, let's say, button from green color to not green. And the event that we are triggering all the time is the change event. So if the initial state of the button is not green, and a change event is triggered on that, it basically moves on to the green state. And from the green state, if a change event is occurred, so it goes on to the not green state. Simple enough. And the structure is almost like current state on a particular event goes to the next state. And where do we handle the side effects? So it gives us a separate actions dictionary, where we define set green as one action, where it adds a class called green to the particular button that was clicked. And remove green will basically remove the class from that button, or the field in this case. So this is the current state, which is not green. On a particular change event, the target state is green, and actions is something that happens during the transition of the states. And it will run the set green function that we have defined here. What this enables us, again, is to reuse the same action for multiple states. So if on moving from one particular state to the other state, there's a common action that needs to be executed. So this kind of interface will enable us that in a very nice way. So how do we model the previous three states solution to the XState library? In fact, this looks a lot more easier to understand, because if I have the initial state as all regions selected, which is the default state, and I do any click on any button, it basically sets the next state as the one region selected. And during the same transitioning of the state, this basically will trigger an action called deselect other than the clicked button. So that is one way of, so that's a three state model. And that still is actually complicated, more than using a particular if statement that we have seen in the beginning. So what's the best way to design this is to actually use a single state. And I have called that state as a default state, because that's the only state it's actually will be in. And that is like non-zero selected button state. So I just avoided the long name. And so what happens is there's a simple state, default state. And there are three click event, and it's a self-transitioning state. On every click event, it basically transitions to the same state. But during the process, it'll actually evaluate a couple of conditions and execute few actions. So this is a one-to-one modeling of our previous if-else statement. So the one more reason why we don't model the entire user interfaces as state machines or state charts is modeling the simplest if statements is not very intuitive, as much as we have something like if-else statements. But state charts with XState, it is solved very nicely. We still can do the same things. So all of us know that a state machine will be helpful when we have like 10, 15 states and 5, 6 transitions. That's still a good use case for the state machines. But what if we want to actually model the entire application using a state machine? And it depends upon use case. I'm not recommending to do that. If you really are into building a product or a platform where your target customers or the non-technical audience who has to do drag and drop and design a custom and flexible application. In our case, we want to build a dashboard building application, but not at the cost of losing flexibility. So a domain consultant should be able to do it on their own. And we want, if a particular custom feature is not available through the interface, the code generated from the interface should be handed over to the developer. The developer adds the feature that is not added and gives back the same code. The code should be uploaded to the interface, and the interface should still show the updated code and handle it. Most of the solutions out there only does it in the one way, where the application user basically builds a graphical user interface. He models it in the GUI and exports the code. But once the code is exported, he can't again upload it back and actually rebuild on top of that. So this is where actually the XState comes, because it's completely declarative. The declarative nature of this will enable us to create interfaces. So this is the same code, which we are doing it in the single state. So we have a couple of conditions, and on off, the target is always the default, because it's a self-transitioning state. And the action is, again, the same actions. We have actually put it in the actions tab, which are defined at the bottom. The guards are the list of conditions that we are evaluating. OK, so XViz is one of the state charts visualizer. So what it does is it takes the state chart that we have created and create the, so if I copy paste my code from here, let me update this. This basically, okay, that doesn't refresh actually. So I can actually copy paste my entire state machine into this and click on the update, and that will create the states here. And this basically on click of a particular event here, which is a change event, it basically toggles between the not green state and the green state. In the similar way, we can take the entire code that we have here and paste it in the same thing, update, and now we see the default state, which is the single only state, and the rest of the ones are basically the guards conditions that will actually transition to the same state, executing few side effects in between. So what are the pros of state machines? I haven't actually sold the state machines concept as much as the outside front-end community does, because they actually picked a lot more complex examples. For me, I want to show that even a simple if statement can actually be modeled in state charts, and that can actually be equally used for both simpler cases and the complex cases. And a state chart is a very great communicator. If you are in an organization where you have to deal with multiple background people, and most of them is like non-developer audience, then you can actually, it's a common communication medium because it's basically a bunch of flowcharts. You can actually communicate to a designer because designer, when designing an application, thinks through flowcharts. And what are the cons of this? So this might have this might lead to a lot of lines of code, but that was mostly because of the configuration. Even if it is more lines of code, each line will probably be a couple of words. And the other important factor is the need for upfront thinking and modeling it. So what next? What can you do from, what are the takeaways from this talk? Or how can you actually, you start using state charts whenever there's a particular use case that you are figuring out? Statecharts.github.io introduces this concept of state charts very nicely. So this is one page that actually talks about what is a transition. So it shows the transitions in the particular state chart. In the same way, whenever I click on an action, it shows the entry and exit. Okay, on entry transition, on exit transition. The actions are the turn light on, turn light off. There's a self transition. So spectrum.chat is the place where all the state machine enthusiasts actually ask questions and get responses. And this is the link for XState library. So that's it. Thank you very much. Questions?
Thanks, Tejesh, for taking us through state machines. Any questions from the audience? Anybody with the questions? Thanks, Tejesh. That's it. I think we don't have any questions. Next up, we'll break for. We'll have a break. The tea and coffee will be served in the same place as we had lunch. After that, we'll have BYF sessions. First one will be moderated by Riaz Walikar, Karan Saini, and Shreyans Pandey around security and how you. It's a session where you're generally gonna discuss. There's gonna be no mic. It's a general discussion sessions. So after that, we are gonna have another session around architecture and design in general. So we'll start that at 4:30. Yeah. Now we can break for tea.